in the highest office, tell them, and this is what you have to do from that hour to that hour, and so on. So you make them feel as if they're just that, just workers for a company or for profit or for rich people owning the company. You want them to feel proud of their role in the whole project.
Of course, you're going to have the 1 or 2%. You have them everywhere. But you cannot determine the system on the 2% that screw it up for everyone else. Then you'll have to filter and find new employees, I guess.
I'm very happy to have a job that makes it possible to work from home a lot. Even teaching is possible from right here where I sit now. Of course, I talk to my laptop, so to speak, but hundreds of students can listen in. And do I miss something? Yes, of course, I miss the interaction. And when you tell a joke and you hear nobody laugh, it's a strange experience in a sense. You don't know what's going on. You have to guess, in a sense. So of course, I miss that. But being at home for me, I mean, I have to read and write a lot and prepare lectures and classes and email a lot with people professionally. So for me, it's perfect. Because very, very often when I go to university or drive to a lecture, in normal times, I'm in a traffic jam. I lose time. I'm wasting gasoline and so on. But of course, there's another side as well. And I think it depends on the kind of person you are too, of course. Some people are good at being alone or just with their partner in one house or their cat or dog. I happen to be one of these people. I mean, I like to be with other people, but I'm very happy also to be in my own house and get lost in my books and research and my writing. So for me, it's not an issue. I don't have the urge to be in a social context professionally. But I can imagine for other people it's different. Other people, when after 2 or 3 days, when they don't see anybody, they get lonely and they crave for the social contact. And of course, that's a different thing. But then again, also on the other hand, if we didn't have the internet and Skype and Zoom and Facebook and all these things, it would be much worse, of course. Then you would truly be alone if you don't have a partner. Or if you do have a partner but you don't get along, it's even more dramatic. So there's a plus and a minus. It's a bit a dualistic thing in a certain sense.
For me, I always still go to the hospital and I have my consultations live, because for me, this kind of conversation is not the same as a real life with physical approach. But I see that in some younger colleagues, they say, well, this kind of consultation even goes better. It's okay for them when their patients agree. But for me, I like to have the real life and real time work for me personally. So everybody has to see what for them is useful, important, and what works best.
So when I was traveling, I would normally reserve time because I was away from the family. It's like, right, I can immerse myself in something and keep unsocial hours because it affects nobody in my family. And so therefore I would, emphasize my working away. And then when I came home, I would actually not really be working. I would be running on a much lower gear. I'd be doing admin stuff. I'd be catching up with things. I'd be arranging things. And I'd be kind of idling through some technical stuff. But I wouldn't consider myself and say, oh, yeah, I'm now working from home. I would say I'm at home. So in that sense, working for myself, that gives me an autonomy that in theory says you can, you're your own boss, you can be working from home, but in my head, that's not how I viewed it. That has clearly changed in the pandemic. And that's actually a work-life thing I've had to readjust to, is actually I do work from home. And that's a huge shift. In that sense, I'm still my own boss. I don't travel. I am able to do my work from home. But now where I rest and where I relax is exactly the same place as where I do my work. That has been a huge shift, and it's a mental shift.
Well, I prefer calling it working from anywhere, because working from home is problematic for a lot of people. Like I said, I consider your home as a special place that is different from work, and that is different from the so-called third place. A third place is a place where you feel safe enough so you can complain about stuff happening at home or at work. It used to be like a bar or your friends in the football team. So you need these three places, and they need to be separate. Because when they merge, lots of conflicts arise because there's different stuff going on in these three places. So if you have to work from home, you're actually combining two places, work and home, into one space, literally, and that is that gives rise to a lot of conflict.
One of the reason people go back into office is not because they are expected to by somebody else, because we sometimes need it. We do need that face-to-face contact, that in-the-room contact. And one of the interesting contrasts that my wife pointed it out to me the other day, she said that I have gone from being the person that travels the most in our household and sees the most people and meets the most different people in a given week to being the person who meets the fewest. I've got a son at university and a son at school. My wife works at two different schools, and they go out, they are in different places. My bubble is surprisingly small, and I interact with a lot of people on screens. Good grief, I've got three screens. I've got plenty of places to put people on flat 2D surfaces. But honestly, being in the same room sometimes, you just can't beat it.
It's like everything, I think. It's not purely good or purely bad. The negativity or the positivity comes from how it gets implemented and how we use it. I mean, I can see working from home for some people would be a benefit, maybe, to be able to regulate their social life around their children or around the family with the life, the working life. But on the other hand, there is a danger of alienation. We've seen this since the emails, actually, since the smartphones. You're always on call. Your boss, your employer can send you mails in the weekend and then ask you on a Monday, why didn't you answer the mails? You say, yeah, I don't work on a Saturday and Sunday, but so you always have to be, you're always working. You're always working, or you're always on call. You never have free time. So work and private life become one thing. The company, who you work for, take over your life. You may think, okay, I'm working from home, so it's okay. But the thing about working from home is you lose all aspects of 8-hour day or 40-hour week or 50-hour week or 20-hour week or whatever, because the hours become undefinable. Work is always there to be done. And you can say, yeah, but now this morning I take my child to the dentist or whatever. Yeah, but you'll be working till 11 o'clock this evening, and maybe you'll take your time, so you'll be trying to fit this work in with how your private life is. And so it all sort of mixes into one. And at the same time, you're being alienated from your workmates and seeing and meeting and honing your social skills, how to get on with other people in the office environment. So yeah, it's a difficult one. The danger I see is you become part of the company and the company takes over your life. Okay. So it's good if you use it good.
A space in your house, which is meant just for work, it's great. But if you are forced to work in the same space where your children live, where the dog is, where your partner is, the same space where you're having dinner, where the kids are playing, where visitors come in, that is not a good idea. It's very stressful. And I know that a lot of people are forced to work like this, and it's not a good thing. And they both physically, for you as your body, all of the impressions that your body and your senses get, and mentally, it is just very unhealthy.
Every situation is different, of course, right? I have a few PhD students, say, and I let them work at home as much as they want. They could be on the other side of the world. But once in a while, you really need that personal conversation. You really need to listen the people out. What are you doing? What are your thoughts on this? How is the progress going on? And so on. So once in a while, I need them to have around me. Also, there's something like, you know, when you become friends with colleagues, you want to shake hands, or you want to hug, or you want to, you know, there's the other side also. It's not just professionally. People sometimes find comfort in a conversation with a dear colleague when things go wrong at home, because not everybody lives in a decent house or is surrounded by good people. So sometimes people are happy to go to their working place, as an escape in a certain sense, away from their house, from their small apartment or their bossy partners or whatever, right? Or noisy neighbors and so on. So it all depends.
It has advantages and disadvantages, like everything. Working at home means for some people more stress because they live in a small house with children running around or things like that. And for other people, they can sit back and take it easy. So we'll have to handle this new way of work. I'm sure about that. Yes, I think we will go to a blended form of work where individually people see what is good for me, and probably some work at home and some in their factory or in their with their colleagues. I think that the Corona time will enhance this kind of work. I'm sure that it will stay.
If you talk to C-level people, they realize that cost benefit, it would be from an economical point of view, it would be a lot better if people could just work from anywhere. And depending on the task that they have at hand and what needs to be done. And it was middle management, because middle management is literally put in the middle between the people who show the way and then the people who actually make it happen. So they're... this is very black and white, but basically middle management, what they do is to make sure that stuff gets done and then report only the relevant stuff to the C-level. And that's basically most of what they did. Some of them also include people, project management, taking care of the financials, for example, but the majority of their task is basically being in between the people who show the way and the people who make it happen. That's a very vulnerable position, because if allowing people to work from anywhere also cuts out the middleman, because you cannot work from anywhere if you are not able to run a project by yourself without someone watching over your shoulder. That's why not everyone can work from anywhere. It's a different way of, you are more in charge of your own job. You get, it's not freedom, it's actually, you get more agency as an employee. And I think this is the way to go, that an organization, an employer enables people to do their job right. And this enabling is more about having a good understanding about what the long-term, the mid-term, the short-term goals and objectives are, how you're going to measure success, how you're going to keep in touch, how you're organizing your team. So it's more about this relationship of trust and shared responsibilities than about showing up on Monday at 9 o'clock.
My father's a type of manager that doesn't look at his employees as cattle. He looks at them as, he cannot do business if his employees are not feeling good. He realized his business is 100% dependent on the employees. So it's a matter of perspective. And if you have that perspective, you respect the employees, you will treat them good, and you will trust them. Because my father always said, if you show your employees you trust them, you give them that trust, then they will return to you. You will actually have a bigger return from them, because they will extra hours. They will not have a problem with picking up the phone in the weekend, because they know that they're respected and appreciated. And it's a give and take.
I would think advise, in a certain sense, employers to leave it up to their, to the people that work in their firm or company or whatever, as much as possible. Because I do think that if you give people enough freedom to organize their job and their lives the way they want it, in the end, the results will be better than if you tell them you need to be here at 8 o'clock. You need to, you know, what's the word in English? A prick clock, you know, prove that you checked in at 8 or 8:30 and you cannot leave before 5 and so on. That to me seems to be counterproductive in a certain sense. Of course, you will have certain people who kind of abuse this flexibility. But the majority, I think, in the end, will do their job with more gusto and more drive, and it will be more meaningful for them. So it's not really the right to be at home or to work at home. It's the right to work the way you want. And of course, the result needs to be good. But in with respect to, if you leave people free, if you respect their autonomy, I think they in general, on average, will also be more proud of what they're doing. It will be more meaningful for them. It will feel less as if it is an obligation, as if it is something I just do because I need the money. You know, if you let people, if you give them the freedom to organize their work the way they want, instead of, you know, from up there in the highest office, tell them, and this is what you have to do from that hour and so on, you frustrate them. You make them feel as if they're just that, just workers for a company or for profit or for rich people owning the company. Well, you want them to be part of your project, of your story. You want them to feel proud of their role in the whole project.
They didn't say it that way. They had no trust whatsoever. Nobody was allowed to work remotely from home. And I just couldn't get it. And I saw more and more, because I was getting quite close to the CEO of Belgium. And I saw more and more that it was just pure matter of trust. Because she said, if I do this for that employee, then I have to do it for the rest as well. And Of course, you're going to have rotten apples, as we say in Flemish. Of course, you're going to have the 1% or 2%. You have them everywhere. But you cannot determine the system on the 2% that screw it up for everyone else. Then you'll have to filter and find new employees, I guess. So that's natural. You will always have people that defy the system. But for the 98%, you will actually get a better revenue. And I saw my attitude change as well. I'm the kind of person that gives 200% to my job, to what I do. And I saw that I actually was doing less extra hours. I was doing less outside of the hours that I would have done for my clients in that job if I had more trust for my boss.
I recently heard the term. I was working with a startup and they said, we are a remote first company. And it was the first time I heard that term because, I mean, we're used to digital first and mobile first. They said remote first. I mean, we don't want a physical space and an office, but you know, we think remote first is our mantra. And I think this is a very interesting evolution. And I think the bigger picture is that it's no longer about measuring whether you show up at 9 o'clock and stay there until 5 o'clock. We're not going to measure basically your attendance. We're going to measure your outcome. I mean, it doesn't matter what you do, where you do it, when you do it. But you know, if we say that's what we would hope to get as a result, that's what we're actually going to do. And I think that's a big shift in terms of the mindset of many traditional managers who would basically, the only control they would have is to see if you would actually show up in time and they would measure time. I think that concept is now definitely passé. I think that is completely gone. And I think we're probably now going to see a lot of hybrids where people say, you know, for sometimes, you know, we're still going to need to get people together because if you want to have some sort of an ideation or brainstorm, or it's you know, important for people to have a physical contact. But for the rest, you're completely free to, you know, do that wherever you want it to do.
I think in the very long run, maybe, I think we will find it more and more obvious that people do what suits them best, what works best for them. If you want to work at home, if you want to work in the middle of the night and sleep during the day, whatever, if you want to work in the weekend and do something else on Mondays and Tuesdays, I'm just inventing here something. If the result is still okay, depending on your job, then what's the problem, right? If you want to move to Australia and you can do your job there, thanks to internet, just as you could do it here in Belgium, then what's the problem? I mean, this was already predicted by Arthur C. Clarke maybe 50, 60 years ago that this would be the situation in the future. He envisioned something that we call now the internet and all the technology attached to that. And so we have to imagine that the speed of the internet and the possibilities will only get better, of course, with 5G and the next generations after that. I'm looking at you now, and it's a pretty clear picture, but it's not yet, it doesn't have the reality feel yet. But I can imagine that's just a question of time, right? Larger screens, maybe more holographic images and so on, will make the experience more real, so to speak. And this could be an acceptable alternative for the actual physical contacts. It would also be good to keep viruses away.